Luciano Pavarotti's commitment to the next generation is legendary. He's a teacher and a talent scout as well as a great performer. And perhaps there's an echo in this evening's concert of his own early career when Joan Sutherland recognized his brilliance and took him under her wing. And it'll be obvious from the first moment on that Mr. Pavarotti has a wonderful time making music with these singers. Tonight we hear a variety of solo arias, duets, everything up to sextets. And from the overture to the amazing scene from Aida, which closes the program, I can't urge you strongly enough to turn on your radio for the stereo simulcast. So, that's what we have in store for you now. A great singer, at the very top of his mature form, celebrating his anniversary with a group of phenomenal young Americans, the next generation.
Our conductor for Pavarotti Plus is Emerson Buckley, who is the artistic director and principal conductor of the Greater Miami Opera, a company with which he has been associated for 35 years. Also, the season 1985-86 marks Emerson Buckley's 24th season as music director of the Philharmonic Orchestra of Florida. And our program begins with the overture to the opera Louisa Miller by Giuseppe Verdi, composed in 1849 when Verdi was 36 years old. Live from Lincoln Center this evening, featuring Pavarotti Plus, has begun with the overture to the opera Louisa Miller by Giuseppe Verdi. Emerson Buckley conducting the New York City Opera Orchestra. And in just a moment, Luciano Pavarotti will make his first appearance of the evening to sing the aria Cielo e Mar from Ponchielli's La Gioconda. Handkerchief in hand, Luciano Pavarotti. From Ponchielli's La Gioconda, Luciano Pavarotti sings Cielo e Mar, the rapturous love song sung by Enzo Grimaldo for his love, Laura.
Cielo e Mar from Act Two of Ponchielli's La Gioconda. Luciano Pavarotti, live from Lincoln Center, from Avery Fisher Hall in New York City. The libretto for Ponchielli's La Gioconda was composed by Arrigo Boito, the librettist for several of the late Verdi operas, and himself a composer. His principal opera, by which he is remembered today, is Mefistofele. But when La Gioconda appeared, for whatever reason, Boito preferred not to be known as its librettist, and so he scrambled the letters in his name, and the letter was then rearranged, and the name of the librettist was given as Tobia Gorio. If you reassemble those letters, they spell the name Arrigo Boito. Now for the first of our pluses in Pavarotti Plus. Maestro Pavarotti will be joined on stage by five young American singers for the sextet from Donizetti's Lucia di Lammermoor. And along with Luciano Pavarotti, we'll have James Morris, Dolores Ziegler, Jerry Hadley, Alan Titus, and Mary Jane Johnson. Emerson Buckley conducting the New York City Opera Orchestra, the sextet from Donizetti's Lucia di Lammermoor.
Thank you.
Chi mi frena in tal momento, the familiar sextet from the opera Lucia di Lammermoor by Gaetano Donizetti. Sung live from Avery Fisher Hall, Luciano Pavarotti Plus. Luciano Pavarotti along with James Morris, Dolores Ziegler, Jerry Hadley, Alan Titus, and Mary Jane Johnson. The New York City Opera Orchestra is being conducted for this concert by Emerson Buckley. Next, we'll have a duet from Bellini's opera I Puritani, Il Rival Salvar Today, and then Suoni la Tromba. The two artists will be Alan Titus and James Morris. I Puritani was the 10th and last opera that Bellini composed. It was premiered in Paris only 8 months before the composer's untimely death. The action takes place in Scotland during the conflict between the Puritans and the Cavaliers. And the duet that we're about to hear takes place in the second act as Sir Giorgio Walton urges his fellow Puritan, Sir Ricardo IV, to help save the life of Lord Arturo Talbot, his rival for the affections of Giorgio's niece, Elvira. Alan Titus and James Morris in the duet Il Rival Salvar Today and Suoni la Tromba from Bellini's I Puritani.
La tua vita là. Suoni la tromba in tre, di occhi io punterò.
Tromba, a duet from Act Two of Bellini's I Puritani, sung here on this gala occasion by James Morris and Alan Titus. This Pavarotti Plus concert, live from Lincoln Center, from the stage of Avery Fisher Hall in New York City. And once again, Alan Titus and James Morris return to the stage. Carol Van Ness will make her first appearance of the evening in just a few moments when, along with Luciano Pavarotti, the two will be heard in another extract from Donizetti's Lucia di Lammermoor, Sulla Tomba, Verano a Te, a duet in which Edgardo and Lucia pledge their eternal faithfulness. They exchange rings and then bid each other an ardent farewell. Carol Van Ness and Luciano Pavarotti.
Io veder ti chiedea, ragion possente a ciò mi trasse, pria che in ciel biancheggi l'alba novella, dalle patrie sponde, lungi sarò.
Amici!
E i franchi lì di amici sciolgo le vele, ivi trattarme dato le sorti della Scozia. Lasciarti, Ashton mi becca, io stenderò placato a lui la destra, e la tua destra pegno, fra noi di pace chiederò. Persecutore, le mani miei ancor pagano me, mi tolse il padre, il mio retaggio rito, ne basta, ne provo ancora quel cuore feroce per io, la mia perdita intera. Let's go.
eterna guerra, io giurai in me il mio furore, ma ti vidi in cuore mio acque, ora traspetto per ira tecue. Pur quel voto ora in pranto, io potrei, sì, potrei compirlo anco.
Io di te memoria vi
Luciano Pavarotti and Carol Van Ness in the duet Sulla Tomba Verano a Te from Donizetti's Lucia di Lammermoor. This gala concert is coming to you live from Lincoln Center. Pavarotti Plus is the generic title for this extraordinary event. Emerson Buckley is conducting the New York City Opera Orchestra. Luciano Pavarotti and Carol Vaness. With one exception, the music that we've heard so far this evening has all been composed by men in their 30s. Donizetti was 38 when he composed Lucia di Lammermoor. Verdi was 36 when he composed Louisa Miller. Bellini was 34 when he composed I Puritani. The next music we'll hear is from Mozart's Don Giovanni, composed when that composer was 31. The duet, La Ci Darem La Mano, from Act One of Mozart's Don Giovanni, to be sung by Cheryl Parrish and James Morris. Again, the fatal charms of Don Giovanni bedazzle another victim, I suppose is the proper word. La Ci Darem La Mano, the duet from Act One of Mozart's Don Giovanni, sung by James Morris and Cheryl Parrish. And they return to the center of the stage here in New York City's Avery Fisher Hall. And this gala concert will continue in just a moment with two extracts from Verdi's Rigoletto. And just to carry the age situation further, Verdi was still in his 30s when he composed Rigoletto. He was 38 years old. The old man among the composers represented in the first half of this concert was Ponchielli, who was the ripe old age of 42 when he composed La Gioconda. The first extract from Rigoletto we'll hear is perhaps the most famous tenor aria that Verdi composed, La Donna e Mobile, in which the philandering Duke of Mantua expresses his cynical and callous philosophy. La Donna e Mobile, women are as fickle as the breeze, and he who tries to win their affection will be sorry. Luciano Pavarotti will sing it as the audience here in Avery Fisher Hall awaits his reappearance on stage. And here is Luciano Pavarotti for La Donna e Mobile from the fourth act of Verdi's Rigoletto. Donne Mobile from the fourth act of Verdi's Rigoletto, sung by Luciano Pavarotti. And next we'll have the familiar quartet from the fourth act of Rigoletto. Our artists will be Dolores Ziegler, Carol Van Ess, Alan Titus, and Luciano Pavarotti. And in the quartet, some of the most beautiful and memorable of all Verdi's music is to be heard. Quartet from Act Four of Verdi's Rigoletto, sung here on this Gala Pavarotti Plus concert at Lincoln Center's Avery Fisher Hall in New York City. Luciano Pavarotti as the Duke. Dolores Ziegler as Maddalena, the sister of Spadafucile, the assassin. Alan Titus as Rigoletto, and Carol Van Ness as his daughter, the doomed Gilda. Luciano Pavarotti and Dolores Ziegler, Carol Van Ness and Alan Titus. Emerson Buckley, who is conducting the New York City Opera Orchestra. The quartet from Verdi's Rigoletto, Bella Figlia dell'Amore, brings us to the intermission point on this gala Pavarotti Plus concert, coming to you live from Lincoln Center. And now, during the intermission, let's go backstage once again and our host, Patrick Watson.
Well, with all that applause flooding over tonight's performers, it's kind of hard not to envy them their lives and their careers. The thrill of making music like that, in that company of superlative talent, the public adoration, the glamour of engagements in London and Milan and Paris and San Francisco. Well, that's the view from the audience side, but if you spend some time talking to these singers, as we've been doing for these last several days, some different factors come into focus, and one of these is the courage that it takes to have a major singing career. These performers live with a terrific vulnerability every moment of their performing lives. Their instrument is in their throat. It's not as if you can go out and borrow another violin at the last moment. And given that terrific encyclopedia of ailments that can wreck a voice, well, it's a wonder that singers aren't a whole lot wackier than they are. And given that a major singer is expected to sing through these hazards, it's a wonder they have the nerve to go out on this or any other stage.
For example, last night I was singing a performance and the stage had not been sprayed with mist before the beginning of the second act, and there was a lot of dust on stage. And one of my colleagues who wears contact lenses was blinking because the dust was getting under her contact lenses. And I suddenly started coughing because of this dust. I was inhaling this dust. I mean, there's singers who on outdoor concerts have inhaled insects. I think every time you travel, you pick up a whole new set of bacteria, and singers are well known for their eccentric behavior, whether or not they wear an extra sweater in a hot building or or stir their bubbles out of their champagne with a spoon. We all have different ways that we cope with these things. And yes, you can be in a new production and everything is going wonderfully, and then suddenly the night before the opening you wake up with a sore throat, and you know, that's a crisis.
Being so what do you do if it's a problem that cannot be sung through? Carol Vaness encountered that nightmare right in the middle of a performance of La Traviata.
And my voice was catching on and off through the whole thing, and I thought, well, this is not working so well. When I get to the recitative, I'll see if I can push my way through it, which used to be my old way of handling anything like this. And I thought, well, I'll just give it a go, and if I can, then I know it's nerves, and it's not that I'm sick. Went through the recitative, trying to push my way through it. It was definitely not nerves. It was an illness. I put my hand out to the conductor, and I said, excuse me, maestro. And he looked up at me with this terrified look on his face. And the audience, it was wonderful. I never got so much attention on the stage. And I said, walked down to the edge of the footlights. I said, I'm very sorry. I'm very ill. And I must stop. And I walked off to greater applause than I'd gotten up to that point on the stage. I must say, though, once I got off the stage, I burst into tears.
The voice had been affected by a virus, but something else had been affected, the singer's self-confidence. Antibiotics can cure the first, but a loss of confidence is more resistant to treatment.
I just thought, well, if this is nerves, then, you know, I just won't sing.
And if the self-confidence is undermined eventually from within or from without to a large extent, it can be as harmful as if there were physical harm to the voice or something missing in the equipment to start with.
Beverly Sills gave me the best advice I've ever gotten, and that was, she called me up, she had sent me flowers, and she said, now Carol, when you get back on the stage on Saturday, because you are getting back on, I want you to sing the part of Traviata, not try to prove that you can sing it. And it's the best advice I ever received.
Singers don't talk much about the fact that one singer's crisis may be another's opportunity, as James Morris discovered when he scored a triumph at the Met as a last-minute replacement.
Cover on the Dawn, and the artist who was singing it that year sang the first performance and then got sick and had to leave. So I stepped in, and so all of a sudden it put you in a different category. And I've still continued to do.
If no singer will admit that he or she prays for such an opportunity, just as few insiders will admit that any single performance can launch a career.
There is no overnight sensation in the classical music business. That is a lie.
I think there is no doubt that there are members of the audience who have that sensation. There are certainly members of the press who do, because they're there that day, and that's when they first are aware of it.
Look at Beverly Sills. She sang many, many years as an artist who was well-regarded but was not considered particularly special. But it was the night of Julius Caesar in the new New York State Theater when she came out and sang that role that absolutely put her on the map worldwide. It was big news. This American girl who'd been around suddenly was a big star. And you felt it in the audience. I'll never forget that night.
Well, now, whether or not there really are any overnight successes, I think there's less of a substantial disagreement here than a kind of difference of perspective. Where you happen to see things from will, of course, affect how you see them. As James Morris says of his recent, quotes, discovery as a Wagnerian basso, the Wagner audiences are asking where I've been. My answer is, singing my tail off for 20 years. But at the heart of the matter, there's something here that isn't a question of perceptions or different perspectives, and that's success. Being recognized as a major singer, being sought after by important conductors, being offered significant roles, being in demand for recordings and television. These define operatic success to insiders and outsiders alike. And what's not obvious to the audience is just how crucial an opera manager is to the attainment of these goals. Top manager is no mere booking agent. He or she guides, shapes, and takes major risks with a singer's career. To be successful, a singer had better find a top manager. And more to the point, the right top manager.
When I presented the idea to Luciano Pavarotti of presenting, of going into the recital world, he said, okay. He said to me, Herbert, there's only one condition that I give you. I said, what's that, Luciano? He says, please, whenever I give a recital, I only want to see two words. I said, what are those? He said, sold out.
There is a mutual complete trust, and that it did work beautifully from the beginning. He never pushed me more than he should sometimes, yes, but doesn't matter.
Remember that we are not ballyhooing in the way Hollywood used to ballyhoo a starlet and make them very successful because either it was beauty or Betty Grable's legs or Rita Hayworth's sultriness or Betty or any of the Hollywood people. That is a world apart from classical music and opera. Opera, classical music, is first and foremost built on quality of your performance. If you do not have that to begin with, forget it.
We are talking about quality. Don't misunderstand me. I'm talking always about quality. Without quality, you don't do anything. But if you give to a good manager your quality, the good manager can really work. There is people with good quality without manager, then they are not there. They are not where they should be. That's for sure.
In fact, to be where you should be, you need to make a whole sequence of important choices correctly, or else.
It's all a little bit like Russian roulette. I think that, you know, you can go to the wrong voice teacher, you can go to a coach who misleads you, you can go to a manager who has the wrong kind of ambitions for you. And I think, again, good talents have been totally ruined along the way by getting in the hands of the wrong people. And in two or three years, the singer has taken on this kind of repertory, and he or she has fallen. It's pushed the voice way beyond. The voice is wobbling, it's falling apart, the vocal cords aren't responding. All kinds of things can go wrong along the way.
On the face of it, I guess it might seem as though strained vocal cords are to a singer what a muscle pull is to an athlete. The hazard of the trade, and there is something in that, but the equivalent's not so much a quarterback with a pulled muscle, it's more a pitcher with a ruined throwing arm, because singing too much too soon or the wrong roles at the wrong time can literally stretch the vocal cords out of shape and that can cause a permanently impaired voice. Something else, the glamour of all that travel. Well, in fact, travel's not exactly one of the perks of operatic success. The reality is that the modern opera singer puts up with a grueling round of hotel rooms and cities and time zone changes that would exhaust an airline pilot. And they do it because they have to do it. The route to better roles and bigger fees leads from San Francisco to Salzburg, and from London to La Scala in Milano and Bayreuth and points in between. So the same drive that put a singer on the stage in the first place propels them on this endless cycle of travel, because today a major career is an international career. Home becomes the number you place your calls to, and home life becomes something the rest of us might not apply the word to.
We're all raised in this country to think that, you know, the American dream consists of having a house with a yard and children and a dog and all of that stuff. You can't do that and do all the things that you need to do to be an opera singer. I know lots of people that, and more power to them, who are able to juggle all that stuff. My wife and I have found that for the 10 years we've been married, children have not been feasible. I mean, we just bought a dog this year, for goodness sakes.
I have spent 3 or 4 Christmases alone. I rarely get to celebrate Thanksgiving. I've often been alone on my birthday. I've had problems in relationships. I've had problems with friends. Of course you give up things, but it's, I don't want to say it's worth it, because it doesn't, it's not that I want to give up all these things, but if someone said, you have your career here, and you have all these other things here, well, I'd have to take this, because this is really me, and this is what I do, and this is what I love. And it's my soul. I wouldn't choose anything else.
The harsh realities are that there's a lot of traveling involved. I'm away from my family a great amount of time. I talk to my kids on the phone, and they're always telling me, Daddy, when are you coming home? We miss you. And a lot of singers face this particular problem. But as some wit said, you put a canary in a cage, don't feed it, and keep its mate away, and it will sing.
But it's so obvious when you begin your profession, then the wife is staying home with the kid, and you are going around the world. That is absolutely impossible to do something different, especially for somebody who is Italian, born in a small city, very fancy but very small, with a very little country background. Sacrifice, I'm talking to my daughter and my wife constantly, every single day. The bill of the telephone is bigger than the bill of the hotel, generally.
It is one of the, I think, the fiercest kind of careers that anybody can have, because you never sit back and say, oh, I've arrived.
In fact, it's when you have arrived that you sense the risks increasing. Luciano Pavarotti has been at it for 25 years, but this last year of superstardom was no easier than before.
This year for me was the year of maximum fear. I opened the Met with Tosca. I opened La Scala with Aida. Luckily for me, they were both very, very good success. The last one in Milan was really glamorous success. I would like to say unexpected, really. Not so big. I was not expecting such a success. And I'm happy for that. I'm very happy. But people is demanding constantly from everybody, not just from me, but I am one of them.
Their responses to those pressures tell you who the major singers are.
Something about their nervous system is excited in a positive way by challenge. When the audition comes, they fly right over it. When the premiere comes, they fly right over it. When they're all of a sudden in front of millions of people on a live national telecast, they fly right over it. Then there are others, beautiful singers, beautiful talents, with something really important to give, who go to pieces in those situations, who are somehow crushed by the pressure, and those people never get far enough along.
That's the fun, you see. I think that there's, I mean, people who like to skydive and who like to, I mean, Mr. Pavarotti has used the expression of walking on a tightrope. It is that, it is the risk factor that gets the juices going, that you know that you're alive from Lincoln Center. And it's that thing that, I don't know, does something, the endomorphins in your brain go off or something, and there's a, that's really the, it's the scary part, but it's also the fun part.
I think you are born like that. There is some gland, and they work to make you produce adrenaline and really go on with that. You cannot do different, because there is a kind of fire is burning inside, and that you are born with.
You go into Luciano's dressing room just before he's ready to go out on stage, and he's run through the major aria three or four times, and I said, how do you feel? And he says, he feels nervous. And that's the, and but that is the most natural response that any artist can have before they go out to a public. Imagine the nerve that it takes to go out before 20,000 or 4,000 people and just stand there completely exposed, relying on, you know, two little chords here in your throat to produce for you the most perfect performance.
But you know something? Despite all those harsh realities of the operatic singer's life, I still think it's an enviable life, and I think most of them do too, whatever they say. Mind you, there is one myth that I am not about to give up easily, and it may be the result of too many movie musicals that I've been seeing, but I intend to keep on believing that understudies get to go on and become overnight sensations, and that singers do burst onto the scene. All these insiders with vast experience are saying that's a total myth, but I say nuts to them. I mean, listen to this from the New York Times about a performance given last year by one of the singers on our program tonight. Sunday, January the 6th will be remembered as the day when soprano Susan Dunn took her first majestic steps into the annals of musical history. Now that's more like it. Isn't that more fun than all those experts who really know what they're talking about? And another thing, I mean, I'm a performer too, in a way. I don't sing that well, but I do know that some of these crises that we performers like to recount with an edge of horror in our voices are in fact some of our fondest memories. At least triumphing over them is. You could sort of sense that when Carol Vaness was telling her story, hmm? She's proud of surviving that. And I'm on her side, breaking through the fear barrier by resuming the role. It's sort of like getting back on the horse after a fall. Everybody says that a beautiful voice is the essence of an important operatic career, and yet they all admit that the church choirs of the world are filled with beautiful voices. Luciano Pavarotti says that his father had a gorgeous tenor voice and could have had a major career, except that he lacked that fire in the belly that you have to have to face up to the terror of performance. Well, in the final analysis, of course, it all comes back to the music, which is what we are about to do. In a few moments, we turn our attention to the stage for the second half of the concert.
And I wonder if you noticed in that New York Times review that Patrick just quoted that the date was January 6, 1985, exactly 1 year ago today, when Susan Dunn sang in an all-Wagner concert. The concert about which the New York Times critic waxed rapturously. This is Pavarotti Plus, live from Lincoln Center, coming to you from Avery Fisher Hall in New York City. And the plus in the Pavarotti Plus designation, I will read their names in alphabetical order. Susan Dunn, soprano. Jerry Hadley, tenor. Mary Jane Johnson, soprano. James Morris, bass. Cheryl Parrish, soprano, Alan Titus, baritone, Carol Vaness, soprano, and Dolores Ziegler, mezzo-soprano. All of them with Luciano Pavarotti and the New York City Opera Orchestra under the direction of Emerson Buckley. We'll be back for the conclusion of this gala concert right after this short pause. Live from Lincoln Center is making available to you, our viewing audience, tonight's official house program for Luciano Pavarotti's gala concert. To receive your free copy, simply send a postcard with your name and address to Lincoln Center, New York, New York, 10023. This is a special edition of the house program that has been distributed to the audience assembled here in Avery Fisher Hall. It features program notes, photographs, informative articles, and profiles of Luciano Pavarotti and his guest artists for this evening's concert. Again, to receive your free copy of this program, send a postcard with your name and address to Lincoln Center, New York, New York, 10023. This program is made possible by a grant from Exxon. Exxon. Quality you can count on in the performing arts. This program is also made possible by grants from the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, the Robert Wood Johnson Jr. Charitable Trust, the National Endowment for the Arts, and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
For centuries, life in rural India has been based on simple technologies. But now, satellite communications are launching even the remotest Indian villages into the 20th century. Television has come to India. This sophisticated technology has opened a window on a wider world. What impact will television have on India? The Global Village, next time on Nova.
Tuesday night at 8 on Channel 3.
India, home of one out of every five people on the planet. A country of madcap modern motion, yet a people frozen in time. Rajiv Gandhi ascended to prime minister after his mother's tragic assassination. Now he struggles to bring India into the 21st century without sacrificing tradition. Explore the challenge of change facing Rajiv's India.
Tuesday night at 9 on Channel 3.
WEDU, Tampa, St. Petersburg.
We're back in Avery Fisher Hall, live from Lincoln Center, to bring you the second part of this Gala Pavarotti Plus program, in which Luciano Pavarotti is joined by eight distinguished young American singers, along with Emerson Buckley conducting the New York City Opera Orchestra. I don't want to belabor the point, but that business of young composers that I spoke of in the first part of the program certainly holds for some of the music that we'll be hearing in the second part. For example, the first music that we'll hear in this part of our program will be from the opera The Pearl Fishers by Georges Bizet. And Bizet was 25 years old when he composed The Pearl Fishers. After The Pearl Fishers duet, we'll hear an aria from Chilea's L'Arlesiana. Chilea was 31 when he composed L'Arlesiana. And later in the second part, we'll hear more music by Vincenzo Bellini, the duet Mira o Norma from the opera Norma, composed when Bellini was 30 years old. As I've mentioned, we'll begin this second part of Pavarotti Plus with the duet Au fond du Temple Saint from Bizet's opera Les Pêcheurs de Perles, The Pearl Fishers. It was Bizet's major opera and predates Carmen by some 12 years. In the duet, which occurs shortly after the first act begins, Zurga, the newly elected chieftain of the Ceylonese Pearl Fishers, is approached by a stranger whom he soon recognizes as his long-lost friend, Nadir. The two of them begin to reminisce about their last voyage together when they visited the Brahmin temple in the city of Kandy. And in their lyrical duet, they conjure up vivid memories of a ravishing, goddess-like, veiled woman who emerged from the depths of the golden, flower-bedecked temple. Their souls reunited by this exotic vision, Nadir and Zurga reaffirm their pledge to be faithful friends unto death.
And our two vocalists in the Pearl Fishers duet will be Jerry Hadley, tenor, and Alan Titus, baritone. Emerson Buckley, for a number of years now, has been a collaborator in musical performances throughout the world with Luciano Pavarotti. And Mr. Buckley was the conductor in Pavarotti's film duet, in the film debut, which was one of those films that captured for the general public, the wide audience, the remarkable artistry of Luciano Pavarotti. And we here at Live from Lincoln Center are particularly proud of our association with Luciano Pavarotti over the years. Some of you may remember the solo recital that Luciano Pavarotti sang at the Metropolitan Opera House, which was the first live televised solo vocal recital by anyone on American television. Here now, Jerry Hadley, tenor, and Alan Titus, baritone, with conductor Emerson Buckley and the New York City Opera Orchestra for the duet Au Fond du Temple Saint from Bizet's The Pearl Fishers.
Thank you.
Titus and Jerry Hadley in the duet Au Fond du Temple de Saint from Bizet's opera, The Pearl Fishers. Pavarotti Plus is the title of this special gala performance here at New York City's Avery Fisher Hall. Luciano Pavarotti and eight young American singers. And the two young American singers whom we've just heard and seen return. Jerry Hadley, tenor, Alan Titus, baritone. And a nod to conductor Emerson Buckley. Next, Luciano Pavarotti will return for one of the great tenor arias from the Italian repertory, Lamento di Federico from Chilea's L'Arlesiana. Chilea is perhaps best known for his opera Adriana Le Couvreur, but this aria, which was premiered and immortalized by Caruso from L'Arlesiana, has remained a favorite. Luciano Pavarotti, Lamento di Federico from Chilea's L'Arlesiana.
Il povero ragazzo voleva raccontarla e s'addormì. Ah!
Luciano Pavarotti in Lamento di Federico from Chile's L'Arlesiana. And did you notice at the end of the aria how long Maestro Pavarotti remained in character before coming out of it and acknowledging the applause of the audience? Nodding to the players of the New York City Opera Orchestra, Luciano Pavarotti acknowledges their performance and that of conductor Emerson Buckley. Next, we'll have the quartet from Puccini's La Bohème, Dunque è proprio finita, Addio dolce svegliare. And our singers will be Jerry Hadley, Susan Dunn, Alan Titus, and Mary Jane Johnson. The quartet occurs near the end of the third act of Bohème, in which the two pairs of lovers each express their own feelings. Rodolfo and Mimi realizing how much they care for one another, and Musetta and Marcello, although having quarreled, experience the same.
Dunque proprio finito, te ne vai la mia piccina.
quartet from Act Three of Puccini's La Bohème. Susan Dunn as Mimi, Jerry Hadley as Rodolfo. And to the left of your screen, Mary Jane Johnson as Musetta and Alan Titus as Marcello. Emerson Buckley conducted the New York City Opera Orchestra in this performance, coming to you live from Lincoln Center on this special Pavarotti Plus gala concert. Susan Dunn, Mary Jane Johnson, Alan Titus, and Jerry Hadley. And next, we'll have the quintet from Verdi's Un ballo in maschera. This music occurs in the second scene of the first act of Verdi's opera. Ricardo, the governor of Boston, pays a visit to the sorceress Ulrica, and in his palm, Ulrica sees that Ricardo will die by the hand of a friend. The masterful ensemble begins as Ricardo scoffs at the grim prophecy. The page Oscar expresses his horror, and Ulrica confronts the conspirators Samuel and Tom, who fear that she has uncovered their plot. Our quintet will be comprised of James Morris, Alan Titus, Cheryl Parrish, Luciano Pavarotti, and Dolores Ziegler. Avery Fisher Hall, where this concert is originating, is the home of the New York Philharmonic. And of course, we've brought you many New York Philharmonic concerts in this Live from Lincoln Center series from this auditorium. Here are our five principals for the quintet from Verdi's Un ballo in maschera.
Scherzo de follia si fatta profezia. Scherzo de follia si fatta profezia. Ma come fa a ridere la lor credulità? Ma come fa da ridere, da ridere la lor credulità?
Scherzo o de Follia, the quintet from Verdi's Un Ballo in Maschera, A Masked Ball. Sung on this Pavarotti Plus gala concert, live from Lincoln Center, by James Morris, Alan Titus, Cheryl Parrish, Luciano Pavarotti, and Dolores Ziegler. And as you can see, a capacity audience assembled here in Avery Fisher Hall. All the seats were sold long ago. Our five singers have returned. Luciano Pavarotti, James Morris, Alan Titus, Cheryl Parrish, and Dolores Ziegler. And next in this collection of solo arias, duets, and ensembles, we'll have the final trio from Gounod's opera Faust. Alerte, alerte, ange pur, ange radieux. This is the final scene of the opera, and Marguerite, having languished in prison, condemned to death for killing the child that she had borne Faust, Faust and Mephistopheles arrive to free her. Now, however, Marguerite recognizes Mephistopheles as the devil. Recovering her reason, she invokes God's forgiveness and salvation. Faust pleads with her urgently to flee with him. Mephistopheles grimly suggests that they hurry, and the sweeping theme of the final trio modulates to successively higher keys, building to an intensity and a dramatic climax. James Morris, Carol Van Ness, and Jerry Hadley. Final trio, Alerte, Alerte, Ange pur, Ange radieux, from Gounod's Faust. Carol Van Ness as Marguerite, Jerry Hadley as Faust, and James Morris as Mephistopheles, with the New York City Opera Orchestra conducted by Emerson Buckley. And again, our trio of singers, Carol Vaness, Jerry Hadley, James Morris, returning to the front of the stage. Next, we'll hear one of the great duets for two women from opera, Mira o Norma, from Bellini's opera, Norma. Our singers will be Dolores Ziegler as Adalgisa and Mary Jane Johnson as Norma. In this duet from the third act of the opera, Norma, the Druid High Priestess, having been deserted by the faithless Roman preconsul, Pollione, resolves to kill herself. She charges the temple virgin Adalgisa, who was now Pollione's lover, to care for the two children that she, Norma, has secretly borne Pollione. In the opening of the duet, Adalgisa begs Norma to reverse her decision out of pity for the children, but Norma chides her for trying to weaken her resolve. Mary Jane Johnson as Norma, Dolores Ziegler as Adalgisa in the duet Mira o Norma from Bellini's Norma.
Thank you.
Jane Johnson as Norma, Dolores Ziegler as Adalgisa, in the duet Mira o Norma from Bellini's Norma. This program of arias, duets, trios, quartets, quintets, sextets, coming to you live from Lincoln Center, a Pavarotti Plus gala. Mary Jane Johnson and Dolores Ziegler. And on stage with them here at Avery Fisher Hall are the musicians of the New York City Opera Orchestra. They're conducted by Emerson Buckley. Next, we'll have the Nile scene from Verdi's Aida with Luciano Pavarotti as Radames, Susan Dunn as Aida, Dolores Ziegler as Amneris, and James Morris as Amonasro. And incidentally, Mr. Morris is filling in almost literally at the last minute for an indisposed colleague. James Morris has never before sung the role of Amonasro. And so we are in on an exciting debut in terms of matching artist and role on this Pavarotti Plus program. The Nile scene takes place in the third act of Verdi's Aida. Aida waits on the banks of the Nile for a rendezvous with her lover Radames, the Egyptian captain who is scheduled to marry the pharaoh's daughter, Amneris. James Morris and Susan Dunn.
Struggi per Radames e t'ama, qui lo attendi, e faraon la figlia e tu arrivare, razza infame, abborrita e eroe fatale.
In suo potere io sto, io d'Amonasro fer.
In poter di lei, no, se lo brani la possente rival tuo.
Rivedrai le foreste imbalsamate, le fresche mani, i nostri tempi d'ore.
Rivedrai le foreste imbalsamate, le fresche mani, i nostri tempi d'ore.
Sposa felice a lui che amasti tanto, tripuri immensi di potrai gioire.
Aida.
Come speri sottratti da neri sai vezzi del re al voler del tuo popolo in corti è stato come
all'aria. Ovi mia Aida, del fiero anerico di nuova guerra il suolo etiope si ridestò. I tuoi già invadono la nostra terra, io degli Egizi duce sarò. Fra il suon, fra il plauso della vittoria, a re di prostro ti svelo il cuore. Sarai tu il certo della mia gloria, mi rendati d'eterno amore. Dei nostri amori,
stose,
Yeah.
The Nile scene from Act 3 of Verdi's Aida. Luciano Pavarotti was Radames. Susan Dunn, Aida. Dolores Ziegler, Amneris. And James Morris, Amonasro. The New York City Opera Orchestra, conducted by Emerson Buckley. And did you notice? One of the violinists in the orchestra plays left-handed. That is, he bows with his left hand and fingers the strings with his right, the complete turnabout of normal procedure. And that, of course, also involves the strings on the violin being strung in reverse order from the normal. Emerson Buckley, Luciano Pavarotti, Susan Dunn, James Morris, the Nile scene from Verdi's Aida. And the musicians of the New York City Opera Orchestra rise to acknowledge the applause of the audience. A very special evening here in Avery Fisher Hall. Pavarotti Plus. Luciano Pavarotti and 8 young American singers in a program of arias, duets, and multiple voices. And as I said earlier, an absolutely packed house here at Avery Fisher Hall to attend this very unique evening. Now, led on by James Morris, all 9 of our singers with conductor Emerson Buckley. And in alphabetical order, our singers have been Susan Dunn, soprano, Jerry Hadley, tenor, Mary Jane Johnson, soprano, James Morris, bass, Cheryl Parrish, soprano, Luciano Pavarotti, tenor, Alan Titus, baritone, Carol Van Ness, soprano, and Dolores Ziegler, mezzo-soprano. The New York City Opera Orchestra has just finished its opera season across the plaza here at Lincoln Center in the New York State Theater. In an innovation begun last year, the season of the New York City Opera is now in the summer, fall, and early winter from July to, roughly November or thereabouts. The Nile scene from Aida is the end of the officially announced program, but obviously there is more music in store for us. And again, our 9 vocalists stretched across the front of the stage here at Avery Fisher Hall in New York City's Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts, along with conductor Emerson Buckley. This has been an extraordinary opportunity for many of the singers whom we heard this evening, not only to appear on live television coast to coast, but also to have the privilege of appearing with one of the reigning superstars of our contemporary opera world, Luciano Pavarotti. James Morris, Susan Dunn, Emerson Buckley, Carol Van Ness, Jerry Hadley, Mary Jane Ender. and the inevitable flowers. To whom do they go? Well, he's out of camera range. I assume Luciano Pavarotti got some. And now Carol Van Ness. Ah, that's as it should be. All the ladies. And from the bouquet that Mary Jane Johnson was holding, a rose to Luciano Pavarotti. Just a few weeks ago, Luciano Pavarotti opened the La Scala season in Milan, Italy, on the 7th of December, the traditional date for the opening of La Scala. And on that occasion, Mr. Pavarotti sang the role of Radames in Verdi's Aida. We shall certainly have an encore, maybe more than one. Luciano Pavarotti applauding the players of the orchestra and calling conductor Emerson Buckley back to the podium. Our encore. Luciano Pavarotti is a native of the small Italian town of Modena, but obviously he has a very special feeling for the songs of Naples. Our encore, of course, the Neapolitan song O Sole Mio, which now is something of a trademark of Luciano Pavarotti's. In fact, the Neapolitan songs generally have been given new and exciting, vibrant life as sung by Luciano Pavarotti in our time. Again, acknowledging the performances of the New York City Opera Orchestra. There is something so remarkably contagious about the artistry of Luciano Pavarotti, which now, of course, causes the audience here to erupt in rhythmic applause. The contagion of Pavarotti's love for the music he sings. As you can see, all the members of the audience here standing and applauding rhythmically. And here comes our conductor, Emerson Buckley. We'll have another encore.
They told me, go there, you are the older. Here we are.
Mare, la sa.
Encore number two, Torna Sviento, sung by Luciano Pavarotti, live from Lincoln Center with Emerson Buckley conducting the New York City Opera Orchestra here at New York City's Avery Fisher Hall. Luciano Pavarotti recently celebrated his 50th birthday, and for exactly half those years, he has been singing on the opera stages the world over. And again, we have the beginnings of rhythmic applause. I was remarking earlier about the love that's evidenced when Luciano Pavarotti sings. Also, the energy level is absolutely extraordinary. Whistles punctuating the rhythmic applause. Obviously, this audience does not want to go home. An exhalation. And once again, Luciano Pavarotti calls our conductor, Emerson Buckley, back to the podium. We'll have yet another encore.
Oh,
I don't know if you heard in the voices that were raised just before the start of that, there was one female voice that called out, Nessun Dorma. And that, of course, is what we have. The tenor aria, Nessun Dorma, from Puccini's Turandot, sung as the third encore on this Pavarotti Plus program. As now Luciano Pavarotti has called out the eight young American artists who collaborated with him this evening on Live from Lincoln Center.